So the next speaker is Miquel Sola, Professor Miquel Sola, from University of Girona in Spain. Professor Sola was appointed assistant professor in this university in 97. He got two distinctions for the promotion of university research. He got one distinction in 2001. And in 2003, he got permanent position of full professor in this university. In 2013, he got the Physical Chemistry Prize of the Spanish Royal Society of Chemistry, and is co-author of 30 book chapters and 350 papers, with a very huge number of citations. And the title of the talk is Connecting Hydrocarbon and Boron Hydride Chemistries and Bidimensional and Three-Dimensional Aromaticities. So, Professor
Sola. Thank you very much, Sherman, for the presentation, and thank you for your presence here. And let me start by also thanking the organizers for giving me the opportunity to give this talk, especially to Professor Clara Viñas. Today I'm going to talk about a way we have found to connect hydrocarbon and boron hydride chemistries, and also the two-dimensional aromaticity of hydrocarbons like benzene and clozoborane, the three-dimensional aromaticity of clozoborane. This work has been done in collaboration with Jordi Poitet, who is now in the University of Barcelona, and with Clara Viñas, Professor Clara Viñas, and Francesc Teixidor, who are in the Institute, in the Molecular Materials Institute in Bellaterra. So this is the outline of the talk. Give a brief introduction, and then I will show you how we connect these hydrocarbons and boron hydride chemistries and the two-dimensional and three-dimensional aromaticity, and finally some conclusions. So let me start by the introduction, saying that hydrocarbons are the paradigm of simplicity. So you know that when we start explaining chemistry to high school students, we start with hydrocarbons because they are simple. They have that, just two center, two electron bonds, carbon-carbon or carbon-hydrogen bond. They have this linear concatenation, and usually the coordination does not exceed four coordination. And I mean, you have also this multiple bond, different hybridization. So in principle, the molecular structure of these systems are quite simple. When we move to boron hydrides, the things get a little bit more complicated, and this is because boron is electron deficient, so boron does not like to have two center, two electron bonds. They prefer multicenter bonding. Linear concatenation is not usual. They make, in general, clusters, and they can reach a coordination number up to seven. So, and in addition, multiple boron bonds are not usual. So this is the situation. In fact, this is a work by Alexander Boldirev some years ago, and they computed, this is theoretical work, they computed the classical structure of boron hydrides, and they compare with the non-classical structure. So for instance, let's take this molecule here. This is B2H4, and this is the classical, let's say, structure, which is the same that the one that we have in ethene. Or ethylene, then, I mean, this structure is about 30 kcal per mole higher in energy than the structure you have the two CH2 units staggered. And it's about 60 kcal per mole less stable than the non-classical structure with three center, two electron bonding. When you go to butadiene, let's say, so B4H6, this is the classical structure. This one is 88 kcal per mole higher than the non-classical one with multicenter bonding. So this means that when you increase the N number in this BN, HN plus two series, the non-classical structure becomes more and more stable as compared to the classical one. Also, there is, if you want this example, that compares the cluster of carbon-4 to plus and boron-4 to minus. They are isoelectronic. And the comparison is between the concatenate, so the linear arrangement or the D4H arrangement. And you see that in the carbon, these two are more or less, let's say, degenerate. They have similar, very similar energies. However, in the case of boron, the cluster, the D4H symmetry is much preferred, so by about 22 kcal per mole. Also notice that the bonds are much longer in boron than in carbon. And this is the reason is because the p orbitals are more diffuse, so the best overlap comes at longer boron-boron distances. And then because of that, the, let's say, the pi bonding is also less effective in this case. So at the end, you get longer bonds in the case of boron than in the case of carbon. So there are, clearly two chemistries that are clearly very different, but also they have some similarities. And if you compare here ethane and diborane, you see that the structure at certain points has many similarities, and also the molecular orbitals also resembles in the two cases. So we thought that it could be interesting to find a way to relate the two chemistries in a similar way than it was formulated, the isolobal principle by Hofmann, that establish a link between the organometallic and organic chemistry. So could we try to establish a link between the boron hydride and hydrocarbon chemistry? This was the question that we started to try to answer. And okay, the inspiration came, among other things, about this work, for instance, of Alexander Boltiev. And you see here that the title is clear, electron transmutation, boron acquired an extra electron becomes carbon, right? So they put these two examples. So if you take CH4 and you change carbon by boron minus, then you get BH4 minus, which of course chemically, the chemical properties are very different, but the molecular structure is and the electronic structure is relatively similar. And also if you take ethane, you can make this B2HC2 minus that it could be the analogous of ethane in the boron hydride chemistry. Okay, in this other paper, they did something similar. They changed benzene to B6H6 minus. This molecule is not stable as an ion, but if you put counter ions, you put lithium ions in this molecule, then it becomes planar like the benzene molecule. So it resembles as much benzene, let's say. Okay, so you have here another example. This is an experimental one. So you have this kind of rings here, and these kind of rings are obtained when you take the tropelium ion and you change one carbon by boron minus, right? Then you get these rings here that are called boripenes, right? But the other way around, it also works. I mean, if you now take, for instance, you take carbon and you remove electrons, then carbon starts to become boron in some sense. And this is an example you have here. You take benzene, and now you remove two electrons, so you have C6H6 2+, and the most stable structure for this molecule is the one that you see here. So in this case, you have the CH group that is eta-5 coordinated to the cyclopentadienyl anion. So this, in this situation, this carbon is hexacoordinated, so it's not a classical structure anymore, so it becomes, in this sense, it seems like boron that prefers this kind of cluster structure than carbon, right? If you remove two electrons more, then you have this type of structure, which is the most stable isomer for C6H6 4+. And you see here, this structure here, this is very similar to the one that we found, for instance, in closoboranes, in B6H6 2-. In fact, you can change the carbon by boron minus. In this case, if you change four carbons, you get this carborane, which is this structure here. Or if you change five carbons, you get this anion, which is a structure here. Or if you change the six carbon, then you get the closoborane, which is this structure here. So you see that in some sense, when you remove electrons from carbon structure, from hydrocarbons, then you get something that makes clusters, and this is what boron also does. So it's the same idea. So by electronic transmutation, we can, let's say, transform ethane to this B2H4 2 minus, this anion. By doing this, remember that the valence electrons stays the same, keeps the same. So we have 12 valence electrons, and if we consider this part of the space, so this confined space that we call in this space in the space where the electrons, the bonding electrons are, we have 4 electrons in the two cases, right? So, but and now if we have this molecule, this B2H4 2 minus, and we want to make diborane, we just have to add 2 protons. And by adding 2 protons, we do not change the number of total valence electrons. And these protons have this 1s orbital low in energy that it's ideal to form these 3-center 2-electron bonds that we have in diborane, right? So we call this atom, we call it a sacrificial atom. And you can use not only proton as a sacrificial atom. In some cases, we have used, for instance, B3 plus or B, or this fragment, BH4 plus. All these fragments have no valence electrons. So when you add this fragment, the number of total valence electrons keeps exactly the same, remains exactly the same. Okay, so taking this into account, we have formulated a method that is called the electronic confined space analogy. And the process goes in that way. So you take the model organic compound, then you define the confined space, then you transmute all carbon atoms into boron minus, and for each boron bond, you can add, let's say, a sacrificial atom, in general, a proton, right? And then you generate the final structure by structural relaxation. So let me show you. So these are the abbreviations. So CS means confined space, ET electronic transmutation, SA sacrificial atom, and SR structural relaxation. So this is what we did. So this is the most simple example. You take methane and you depict the confined space, and by electronic transmutation you get this boron hydride. Of course, the chemical properties are very different, but the molecular structure and the electronic structure is similar. So this was already done in the work by Alexander Boldrieff and Olson. So, but now let's go to ethane. And now we do the same. We draw the molecule, we depict the confined space, we do the electronic transmutation, so you change from the neutral to 2 minus species, and we add a sacrificial atom. We add only one sacrificial atom because we have only one boron bond. And then you get this anion here. Okay, this anion, I mean, the homolumo gap for this anion is relatively high, and also the frequency, the boron frequency is significant. So, in principle, this species is stable, and in fact, it was synthesized in 1989. So, this is called the heptahydrodiborate ion. So, this is already known, was already known, and this is an analogous to, in the hydrocarbon chemistry, to ethane. On the other hand, this has not been synthesized yet, so it's a target for future synthesis, this D-anion. And in principle, we think that this is stable, and if you try to break the boron bond, this takes this unit about 50 kcal per mole. Okay, now you can take, for instance, ethylene, and you can do the same. You can do one electron transmutation, and then you have negative charge, two electron transmutation, two negative charge. And because we have two boron bonds, we can add one or two protons. If we add one proton, we get this anion. And if you add two protons, then we have diborane. So we think that these two, let's say, are analogous in the way we are establishing this connection. So these two systems have not been synthesized yet. So maybe they could be target for future synthesis. And the other ones are, in fact, known. This is, of course, diborane, but also these anionic diborane have been synthesized, not with hydrogen, but with other R substituents. So now let's move to the next one, acetylene. So again, the same, you can do one electron transmutation, negative charge, two electron transmutation, two negative charge. And then in this case, you have triple bonds, so you can add up to 3 protons. If you add one, you get this species, two, this neutral species, and 3, this cationic species here. And okay, these 3 systems remains to be, let's say, synthesized or discovered, but the other two have been synthesized by different people, by Batsuo and co-workers, not with hydrogen, but with other substituents. So, and you have here other examples. For instance, this cyclopropanium cation, right? So the equivalent would be this boridine, right, in which you have substituted one carbon by a boron minus, or this dianion, which is cyclo-B3R3 dianion, right? Or in the cyclobutadiene, the cation, all these systems have been synthesized. You have the equivalent would be this 1,3 diborides, or for this butadiene dication, you have the, oh, there is a bone missing here, the diboryl olefins. And all these systems have been synthesized by Braunschweig and other authors. Okay, and now if you want, you can go to benzene and you can do the same. You can do one electron transmutation and you get this anion 2, and then you have different isomers, 3, 4. In principle, you cannot go, you cannot transmute 5 because then it's simply the system becomes, I mean, the structure is not optimized, it dissociates. But in principle, if you would add contour ions like lithium plus, then this would be possible, right? And okay, once you have the B6, H6, 6 minus, then you can add, for instance, 3 protons in these double bonds here, and you get this 3 anion, and then you can add more protons if you want to make the system neutral. You can add 3 protons more, and then you can add the protons in this boron-boron-bond, and then you get this structure here, or in this boron-boron-bond that does not have the hydrogen bridging the two borons, and then you get this structure here. So these are the structures that you get, and this one, so this one here is more stable by 66 kcal per mole. And if you look at the structure, it's like you have 3 concatenated diboranes, right? In this case, you have this situation. I mean, this is not, I mean, this is, in principle, this molecule has not been synthesized, but maybe it could be synthesized in the future. And in fact, this one was synthesized in 2012 by 7 co-workers. And you see that they have this structure in one of the benzyl, the double bonds, let's say. Yeah? So in principle, I mean, this could be also a target for future synthesis. Okay, now you can take C60 if you want. C60, you do also the electron transmutation, and then you have 60 negative charges. And then if you want, you can put hydrogens, but we, in this case, we suggest to use as a sacrificial atom the B3+. So, I mean, to make the system neutral, we need 20 of these cations, right? So, and as you know, in fluorine, we have 12 pentagonal rings and 20 hexagonal rings. So it seems a good idea to use these hexagonal rings to add a boron in that position. And this is what we did. And from here, you get this structure, and this is this B80 fluorine, which has been predicted theoretically, but has not been yet synthesized experimentally. But okay, throughout the process, of course, you keep the same number of valence electrons all the time. Okay, and now let me show you how we connected the two-dimensional and three-dimensional aromaticities. So the two-dimensional aromaticity of hydrocarbons like benzene or cyclopentadienyl anion and so on with the three-dimensional aromaticity of these systems that they are clozoburanes. So clozoburanes, you know perfectly well, are these systems with the BN, HN, 2- formula. And they have a polyhedron structure with triangular faces, so they are called also deltahedrons. So, okay, they are prepared by pyrolysis of diborane. They are very, some of them, especially B12, H12, 2-, very stable, so this one does not decompose below 600 degrees. And with the exception of the system with N equals 8 and 11, they are quite rigid. So these two are relatively fluxional, but in general, they are quite rigid. And they react usually through electrophilic substitution and not addition. So, I mean, all these properties indicate that these are aromatic systems. And in fact, I mean, other properties like calculation of Nicks or Bohr-Lange equalization or resonance energies also indicate aromaticity in this species. And this species, you know, they follow this weight Mingo rules, right? The Mingo rules looks at the total number of valence electrons. So the rule is 4n plus 2, and n is the number of vertexes. And in the case of Weight's rule, they look at the skeleton electrons. This means that weight remove the boron, hydrogen, two center, two electron bonds that do not participate in aromaticity because they are localized, right? So because we have 2n of these bonds, then the rule changes from 4n plus 2 to 2n plus 2. I have to say that this was the first rule of three-dimensional aromaticity. Later, it comes the huge rule of spherical aromaticity. There are two rules. They are different because they refer to different things. In the case of fluorines, we have the aromaticity in the surface, let's say. The electrons are delocalized in the surface of the fluorine. In this case, it's different. The aromaticity is not in the surface because we have this boron hydrogen localized two center two electron bonds, but we have the aromaticity in the cage, inside the cage. So it's two different types of aromaticity, so this is why we have two different rules. And this is how we connect this Wade-Mingus rule with the 4n plus 2 Hickel's rule of that applies to hydrocarbons. For instance, let's take a cyclopentadienyl anion. You have the cyclopentadienyl anion here. You do the electron transmutation, so now you have six minus charges. And now, as a sacrificial atom, we add a fragment BH4+. This fragment has no valence electrons, just without valence electrons, it comes and forms this pentagonal pyramid. This is a minimum, but if you just allow to relax the geometry, then it becomes this octahedron, which is B6H6 2-. So as you can see here, the bond length alternation is zero in both cases, and the nicks are negative in the two cases, indicating aromaticity in the two systems. So we connect, in that way we have connected a hydrocarbon that is aromatic with a closed borane that is also aromatic. And we can do the same, okay. And if you look at the molecular orbitals, for instance, of the B6H6 2-, you will see that, okay, each BH unit has four valence electrons. Two of these units are needed to form the two center, two electron bonds, BH bonds, and the rest, they come into the cage, right? So you have now, let's say you have six pairs, you have 12 electrons coming from these BH units plus the two electrons coming from the negative charge. So you have 14 electrons, seven electron pairs, and these seven electron pairs goes to these seven orbitals here. And they have a close, and then you have a closed shell electronic structure that this is the one that gives an extra stability to the system and provides aromaticity to this closed borane clusters. You can do the same with benzene, and now with the electron transmutation, you add a BH4+ unit. In this case, this hexagonal pyramid is not a minimum, and it evolves to form this pentagonal bipyramid. And as you can see here, the negative values of the nicks indicates aromaticity for this system. In this case, there is some difference between the shortest boron-boron distance and the longest boron-boron distance is this value here. But still, I mean, we consider that both systems are aromatic. And if you want, you can take now a fused hydrocarbon like naphthalene. You can do exactly the same. So now you have this system with 10 negative charges. Now you add two BH4+ groups, and then you get this kind of structure. And, okay, again, you have the negative Nix values, and, okay, there is some bond length alternation, but, okay, this is because of the fused nature of the closed borane that you have in this case. Or you can make higher closed boranes, but in this case it's a little bit, let's say, more tricky in the sense that we start with the all these aniline, C10H10, then we make the electron transmutation, we have 10 negative charges, and then we have to add two BH4+. And before we do that, we have to deform, we have to make a deformation of this aniline in order to add the two BH sacrificial atom in that position and get the B12, H12, 2-. And okay, these two molecules do not have bond length alternation and the Higgs value are quite negative. So in that way, I mean, we think that we make a connection between the two rules. The 4n, we start with an aniline that follows the 4n plus 2 Hickel's rule, and we end up with a closure borane that also follows the 4n plus 2 Wade-Mingus rule. The n, however, have different meanings. In the case of the Wade-Mingus rule, the n means the number of vertexes that the closure borane has. In the case of the Hickel rule, the n is simple natural number, and then you have this 2, 6, 10, 14, and so on. The system with this number of pi electrons, they follow this rule. So we start with a system having 4n plus 2 pi electrons, and we finish with a system that has 4n plus 2 total balance of number electrons, total number of balance electrons. Okay, so you can do this kind of, let's say, analogy. So all these hydrocarbons here, all they have 6 pi electrons, right? And you can go from C4H4 to minus to B5H5 to minus by this procedure, or from benzene to B7H7 to minus, as I showed you before, and so on. Or you can take these anilines that they, all of them, they have 10 pi electrons, from the one that is has a double negative charge to the one that has a double positive charge, all have the same number of pi electrons, and they are analogous to this, all these closure boranes, and finally, this group of 14 pi electrons are connected to these closure boranes here. And as you can see here, I mean, so in that way, we can classify the closure boranes in three groups. So the first ones are the ones that comes from Hickel systems with 6 pi electrons. The second one, the ones that comes from Hickel systems with anilines with 10 pi electrons, and the last one that comes from 40, anilines with 40 pi electrons. And interestingly, I mean, if you look at the neutral aniline in all cases, this is connected with a system which has one pentagonal layer. If you look at the neutral system in this case, you have 2 pentagonal layers, and for this neutral system, you have 3 pentagonal layers here. So it becomes, of course, there's increasing complexity when you go from these systems to the last one. Again, the neutral one in general generates a closure borane that is quite aromatic. So this B7H7 2 minus is probably the most aromatic along these series. Also, this B12H12 2 minus is the most aromatic along these series. And this one here, the B17H17 2 minus, is also the most aromatic, and we think that this is probably a good target to try to reach higher numbers in this closure borane family. Okay, with this I'm finished. So just to say that we have established this connection between hydrocarbon chemistries and boron hydride chemistries, and in all cases the total number of valence electrons keeps constant. We think that this ESCA method could be useful to explain the boron hydride chemistry to our students. And in fact, this is what I do in my classes to my students. I explain how to make this connection. So I think this is a way to easily explain the boron hydride chemistry. This connection may help to rationalize to the rational design of new interesting boron containing molecules and materials, and also is useful to rationalize the molecular structure of many compounds that are already known. And okay, we have also established a connection between the two-dimensional aromaticity and the three-dimensional aromaticity in these closure boranes. And this 4n plus 2 pi Hickel rule allows us to classify the closure boranes in three categories. So these are the different papers we have published in relation to this subject. And okay, these are the people that has contributed to the work. So all the work was instigated by Francesc Teixidor and Clara Vinyes from the Institute of Material Science in Bellaterra. And we worked together also with Jordi Poté from the University of Barcelona. So many thanks to the collaborators, and of course the institutions that provide the money for the research, and to all of you for your kind attention. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. We have time for several questions.
Yes, thank you. Very, very nice lecture. And yeah, I would like to stress how important I find it that you actually spell out these connections. But on the other hand, maybe more a comment than a question. This connection, of course, existed before as the aromatic hydrocarbons, the Hückel aromats, can also be considered as arachno-boranes. Simply by as they fulfill the weight counting rules in this regard.
You mean all this the champions work or?
So take for instance the cyclobutadiene dianion, uh-huh. Right? So if you do classical weight electron counting with that, you end up with an arachno species, and this is exactly what it is. Now if you take your method of sacrificial atoms, you can actually do this in the experiment as well. Yeah. If you use lithium plus a sacrificial atom, mm-hmm. it becomes all of a sudden a closal species, mm. right? By simply capping the two planes right. with lithium plus.
Right.
And the same formalism can be done and has been done over and over again with all Hückel aromatic species.
Right, but it seems to me that, okay, yeah, you're right, but it seems to me that in this case with the lithium, what you are doing, let's say, is stabilizing the cyclobutadiene anion, the anion, right? So, but you are placing the lithium, I guess, as eta 4 to the ring, right?
Yes, yeah.
But I would say that it's not exactly the same. I mean, we are, I don't know, but we are, for instance, taking B2H4 2 minus and the hydrogens are making 3 centered 2 electron bonds with the 2 boron. So I think it's not exactly the same.
No, I agree with that. It's not the same. And as I said in the beginning, I find it important to draw these connections and to spell them out in different ways mm-hmm. because it allows new ways to think about these metals.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this talk. Can you draw the same analogies of Hückel anti-aromaticity and Baird aromaticity then also in the excited state?
Okay, this is something that we are working in this possibility at this moment, so I cannot now tell you if there is this kind of connection, but we thought that maybe, I mean, we can connect this anti-aromatic species with maybe arachno clusters or something like that. So it's something that has not been developed yet.
Time for another question. Okay. So last question.
Very quick. I've seen that you discussed and compared your dianion of borirenes with a cyclopropanyl cations mm-hmm. as well. And I know that several years ago were synthesized a beautiful example of transition metal complexes stabilizing cyclopropanyl cations. And I'm wondering, I don't know, but I'm wondering if a similar kind of compounds have been obtained with the triboron system.
You mean with this one here?
Yes, that one or the dianion yeah. or the single anion. Probably with the dianion.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, maybe with this one. As far as I don't know, Andre, so I'm not sure if there is, but this is something that could be in principle attached to some, let's say, transition metal, but I don't know if this has been done or not. So I'm sorry, but I cannot answer this question.
Okay, I think we have to thank the speaker again for this very nice presentation.